Friends, welcome. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon to you. I'm going to just say the obvious. This isn't your ordinary celebration of life, and I think it deserves a little clarification at the beginning. Morris has been teaching me. This is a celebration for Beverly Nelms today, and it is going to be done in the New Orleans style. Which begins sort of with a dirge and then ends with lively music. And I guess that could be characterized as slower moving music to faster moving. That's one way to say it. And I think we're in for a few surprises. But we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Beverly Ann Nelms. So we come together in grief. And we acknowledge our human loss. So may God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, and in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. I'd like to invite you to pray with me this afternoon. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. And you know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace that we may shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death, and help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.
From poems Beverly and I loved and read together. The first one is by William Shakespeare. It's a selection from a sonnet included in The Passionate Pilgrim. This was read at our wedding. If music and sweet poetry agree, as they must needs, the sister and the brother, then must the bond be great twixt thee and me, seeing thou lovest the one and I the other. Song by Dylan Thomas. This refrain, "Love me and lift your mask," was also read at our wedding. Love me, not as the dreaming nurses my falling lungs, nor the cypress in his age the lass's clay. Love me and lift your mask. Love me not as the girls of heaven their airy lovers, nor the mermaid and her salty lovers in the sea. Love me and lift your mask. Love me not as the ruffling pigeon the tops of trees, nor as the legion of the gulls the lip of waves. Love me and lift your mask. Love me as loves the mole his darkness, and the timid deer the tigress. Hate and fear be your two loves. Love me and lift your mask. This is called 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird. It is by Wallace Stevens. Beverly introduced me to Wallace Stevens. I have her to thank for opening my eyes. Among 20 snowy mountains, the only moving thing was the eye of the blackbird. 2. I was of three minds, like a tree in which there are three blackbirds. 3. The blackbird whirled in the autumn wind. It was a small part of the pantomime. 4. A man and a woman are one. A man and a woman and a blackbird are one. 5. I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of inflections or the beauty of innuendos, the blackbird whistling or just after. 6. Icicles filled the long window with barbaric glass. The shadow of the blackbird crossed it to and fro. the mood traced in the shadow, an indecipherable cause. 7. O thin men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the women about you? 8. I know noble accents and lucid, inescapable rhythms. I know, too, that the blackbird is involved in what I know. 9. When the blackbird flew out of sight, it marked the edge of one of many circles. 10. At the sight of blackbirds flying in a green light, even the bawds of euphony would cry out sharply. 11. He rode over Connecticut in a glass coach. Once a fear pierced him in that he mistook the shadow of his equipage for blackbirds. 12. The river is moving. The blackbird must be flying. 13. It was evening all afternoon. It was snowing and it was going to snow. The blackbird sat in the cedar limbs. This next selection is by John Donne, various passages from Devotions on Emergent Occasions. I read this to Beverly when she had lost her uncle and she had lost her mother. Later she told me that this did help. Variable and therefore miserable condition of man. This minute I was well and am ill this minute. I am surprised with a sudden change and alteration to worse, and can impute it to no cause nor call it by any name. We study health, and we deliberate upon our meats and drink and air and exercises, and we hew and polish every stone that goes to that building. And so our health is a long and regular work. But in a minute, a cannon batters all, overthrows all, demolishes all, a sickness unprevented for all our diligence, unsuspected for all our curiosity, nay, undeserved, if we consider only disorder summons us, seizes us, possesses us, destroys us in an instant. Second passage. My God, why comes thine anger so fast upon me? Why dost thou melt me, scatter me, pour me out like water upon the ground so instantly? Thou stayedst for the first world in Noah's time 120 years. Thou stayedst for a rebellious generation in the wilderness 40 years. Wilt thou stay no minute for me? Wilt thou make thy process and thy decree, thy citation and thy judgment, but one act? Third passage. As sickness is the greatest misery, so the greatest misery of sickness is solitude. When the infectiousness of the disease deters them who should assist from coming, even the physician scarce dares come. Solitude is a torment which is not threatened in hell itself. Mere vacuity, the first agent, God, the first instrument of God, nature, will not admit. Nothing can be utterly empty, but so near a degree towards vacuity as solitude, as to be but one, they love not. When I am dead, and my body might infect, they have a remedy. They may bury me. But when I am but sick, and might infect, they have no remedy but their absence in my solitude. It is an excuse to them that are great and pretend and yet are loath to come. It is an inhibition to those who would truly come, because they may be made instruments and pest deducts to the infection of others by their coming. And it is an outlawry, an excommunication upon the patient, and separates him from all offices, not only of civility, but of working charity. A long sickness will weary friends at last, but a pestilential sickness averts them from the beginning. God himself would admit a figure of society, as there is a plurality of persons in God, though there be but one God, and all his external actions testify a love of society and communion. Fourth passage. No man is an island, entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less. As well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or of thine own were. Any man's death diminishes me, because I am involved in mankind. And therefore, never sin to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. And this passage is from Death's Duel, the last sermon preached by John Donne. And he ends with this passage. There we leave you in that blessed dependency to hang upon him that hangs upon the cross. There bathe in his tears, there suck at his wounds, and lie down in peace in his grave till he vouchsafe you a resurrection and an ascension into that kingdom which he hath prepared for you with the inestimable price of his incorruptible blood. Amen.
Is a noisy microphone. That is sacred harp singing. If you're wondering what you just heard, you're going to hear some more. Beverly and I went to a sacred harp singing. The first one she went to was in Henderson, and I can't remember the exact year. And she didn't know any of the songs. because she didn't recognize the title. The title of Amazing Grace in this hymnal is New Britain, because New Britain is the name of the song that goes la, 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 right? This is the name of that tune. And in the old days, they would take books of words and say, okay, we're going to sing New Britain to these words. And this is why you see CM and LM and all those attributions at the bottom of your hymnal. It's telling you if it's CM, you can sing the tune Amazing Grace to it. So my favorite story about Beverly and her experience with Sacred Harp, she grew to love this music and was really frustrated when her illnesses prevented her from being able to go. We used to go all the time to McMahon and Henderson. The first time, she said, oh, they're going to sing Amazing Grace. I know that. For those of you who know Amazing Grace the way we usually sing it in church, you realize that doesn't really sound like Amazing Grace the way you know it. I remember vividly how Beverly reacted. She was like, those of you who know Beverly, did I get it right? Is that's Beverly, right? Yeah. So anyway, like I said, we love this music. Beverly said, told me, the first thing she told me was, I can't sing. I said, don't worry about it. As you can hear, this is very user-friendly singing because, as one of my students said, it's like they yell and form chords. Sacred harp singing is not for the timid. It's not for those who want to sing softly. You sing, right? But the beauty of that is my wife went in, sang in the alto section, and realized this is the wrong key for me. And then she moved to soprano and sang in it's really called treble and soprano in this style, because like Renaissance music, the melody is in the tenor voice. That's why you're not hearing the melody on top. If you want to know classical music that doesn't, listen to Orlando Gibbons and pre-Bach classical music. Okay, Palestrina. I'm talking too much. I love this music. If you've never thought about participating in it, think about it, because you get in the middle of the square and it just washes over you, and it's amazing, especially if you're in a space that's too small for it. That's when it's the most fun. And anyway, I could talk about it for a long time. I fell in love with it. Beverly fell in love with it. We sang it together on the couch when we couldn't go to singings. It's very uplifting. Stephen Hager, my friend, came to a singing once, and he and his wife both said it's like they built a cathedral out of sound. And another thing I'd like to point out is I've got some relatives that are Church of Christ, and you guys sing this way all the time, though not this particular way, but this is the roots of it. The music you just heard, the version of Amazing Grace you just heard, was probably heard by the people of George Washington's time, and certainly by the people of Abraham Lincoln's time. That's the way it originally sounded. So Galen's going to tell you about a tune we're about to do called Calvary, and this was the stuff that William Billings loved, our first great composer, loved about Sacred Harp, because he said, this is when we get to have our musical wars.
Of course, you ought not have the music in front of you, but the note heads have different shapes, and each shape represents a syllable. There's two systems. There's a four-shape system and a seven. We're singing four, so the scale goes fa, sol, la, fa, sol, la, mi, fa. In the book, the right angle triangle is fa, circle is sol, square is la, and diamond is mi. And at these sacred harp singings, we normally sing the notes and then go back and sing the words. And that goes back to the singing school days. So, and this is the only one we're going to do that for, Calvary.
La, 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 la.
Jesus is mine.
Okay, I'm going to be quite honest and say this was intended as a promo to get people interested in singing Sacred Harp, among other things. I would like to add one more thing. You do not have to be a member of any particular religious organization to participate in Sacred Harp singing. Galen has told me a story about a woman who had just been ordained as a Buddhist monk and was wearing a yellow robe and a shaved head, and she liked a song in this book called The Dying Californian. I have met all kinds of people who sing Sacred Harp. You do not have to be religious to get in the square and get a thrill. It's fun. Even if you don't think you're musical, it's fun. Look one up. There's one every third Sunday, right, at Hyde Park in Austin?
Right, at Hyde Park on the corner of Avenue B and 40th Street from 4 to 6.
4 to 6, Hyde Park Presbyterian, right?
Correct.
Every third Sunday. They'd love to see you. I'd love to see you. Sing on.
I'd like to direct your attention to your bulletins if you'd like to follow along by speaking these comforting words from Psalm 23. Let us recite them together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Thank you.
Can you guys hear me? That song was written by one of the greatest iconoclasts in jazz music, a man named Thelonious Sphere Monk. Even his middle name is odd. He was a fantastic pianist. He takes some getting used to. He's different. Okay, Linda's reminding me of a great story I have to tell about Linda and Beverly and myself. We've been driving to the landing and we're listening to, she played Thelonious Monk for Linda first, and then on the way back, we're listening to Art Tatum, who's probably the most technically accomplished jazz pianist that ever was. Fastest mind, all that. And Linda's like, I like him a lot better. Yeah. Okay, why am I including jazz in this service? Certainly, I'm a jazz musician, but Beverly didn't play an instrument. Well, it's real simple. When we met, she came out to hear me and was listening to me play. Before, the first time she met me, she didn't think much of me. She didn't like me very much. And then she heard me play music, and that opened up another window. She said, well, there's something else to this guy. I'm going to check him out. So we're talking one day, and she says, I don't know very much about jazz. I'm like, well, what do you know? You know, tell me what you know. What do you like? Who do you like? She goes, well, I only like a handful of artists. I'm like, really? Well, who do you like? So, well, I like Louis Armstrong. That works. I like Charlie Parker. Okay, by the way, if you don't know, those are the two most important jazz musicians, period, hands down, right? So your taste is already right lined up, right? And she goes, I like Count Basie. And I like Thelonious Monk. And I'm like, yeah. Here's my wallet and my car keys and my will, and I just don't go anywhere. Like a moron, it took me 9 years to say marry me, right? But we stayed together. Now, why this band? Beverly and I went out on her birthday, May 25th of this year. This is the last live jazz she ever heard, and she loved it. By the way, there's one person who's not credited on the bill, and that's my brother Mark, who's here from New York. And I'm gonna embarrass him. This morning I gave him a coffee cup that had a picture of Muhammad Ali winning his fight with Sonny Liston. And so I'm giving this to you because 5 years ago in 2017, after suffering a really terrible stroke in 2001, he decided to move to New York and become a working jazz bass player. And he's still there 5.5 years later. And he works all the time. So.
My hat's off.
My hat is off to you.
Yeah.
All right. Now, Rachel Turgis is going to join us. We're going to pay tribute to a great album that Beverly and I both wore out. It's if you don't have it, buy it. It's Louis Armstrong and Ella Fitzgerald together. There's three CDs worth of stuff. They sing every tune under the sun just about beautifully. It's wonderful. Anyway, this song was George Gershwin's last song. It's called Love Is Here to Stay, and it was the one that it became our song. And
It still is.
Yeah, I was about to say, I mean, for me, it would be very difficult to deal with this if I didn't think some part of us was eternal. I'll just put it that way. And that's what this song is about, too. George Gershwin wrote it. It's the last song he ever wrote. He was 37 years old when he died of a brain tumor. So, wow, George. Put you in the same book with John Donne, right? It's very clear our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may be passing fancy and in time may go. But, oh my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. The Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble. They're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay.
Is here to stay, not for a year, but forever and a day. telephone, and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But oh my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble, they're only made of clay. But our love is here, our love is here, our love is here to stay.
Rachel Turgoose. All right, we're going to do one more because I said since this band was the last band that Beverly heard in person, I said, Mac, I want you to pick something you think the band would sound really good, give them a flag waiver, et cetera. So we're going to do one. It's another one that's really appropriate for what the story I just told about Beverly. It's called It's You or No One. Thank you. thank all these guys for coming. They drove from San Antonio.
Ooh, hard to follow that. Take me to church. I wish Sunday morning was always like that. Amen.
Thank you so much.
Well, come on. You know I'm always game. But I'm going to follow it with scripture. Our Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 28 through 31. Hear this word. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. The New Testament lesson is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 through 58. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, I would invite Carol Horton forward.
Hello. Good to see you all here today. I'm so glad you're here. Well, my life has been entwined with Beverly's for so many years and in so many ways. One of the ways is a long-running book club that we both belong to, along with Morris and several other people here today. The book we're currently reading is one that I think Beverly would have really liked. It's called The Midnight Library by Matt Haig. Its premise is that somewhere out beyond the edge of the universe is a library that contains an infinite number of books, each one the story of a different reality. One book tells the story of your life as it is. All of the others tell about the other lives you could have lived if you had made a different choice at any point in your life. This isn't a book review, though. The reason I'm mentioning it is that it got me to thinking about Beverly. You know, in another life with different choices, Beverly had the keen intelligence to be an astronomer or a gemologist. She could have chosen to be a missionary, a psychologist, or a play therapist that helped children overcome trauma and adversity. Beverly could have been a poet or a novelist, or a professor of literature. She could have been a great designer of jewelry, or a fiber artist, or a professional baker. Oh, wait, she was a professional baker. But Beverly made different choices that didn't lead to fame and fortune. She chose to love others as Christ loves us, to offer hospitality to all who knew her and many who didn't know her before they basked in her light. Beverly never made it to college, but she spent her whole life educating herself, as well as any university could have done. And in her own way, she was an astronomer, a jewelry designer, a gemologist, and a poet, and a nurturing, empathic person whose very presence was healing to all she knew. She found ways to pursue all the things on earth and in the universe that captivated her interest. She read at least 10 times as much as I ever did. And oh, could she ever bake? I know that many of us can attest to that. But I believe that what was most important to Beverly was love, with a capital L. To quote Shakespeare, her love was as boundless as the sea, and she poured it into her husband Morris, her family, friends, many, many cats, one big dog, and countless other humans she never even met. Just a minute. Oh, thank you. I wasn't going to do this yet. If God is love, as we're told, then Beverly was a very godly woman. I learned so much from her, and I miss her terribly. Here's a poem, if I can read, that reminds me of her and reminds me to love others the way she did. It's called Messenger by Mary Oliver. My work is loving the world. Here the sunflowers, there the hummingbird, equal seekers of sweetness. Here the quickening yeast, there the blue plums. Here the clam deep in the speckled sand. Are my boots old? Is my coat torn? Am I no longer young and still not half perfect? Let me keep my mind on what matters, which is my work, which is mostly standing still and learning to be astonished. The Phoebe, the delphinium, the sheep in the pasture, and the pasture, which is mostly rejoicing since all the ingredients are here, which is gratitude to be given a mind and a heart and these body clothes, a mouth with which to give shouts of joy to the moth and to the wren, to the sleepy dug-up clam, telling them all over and over how it is that we live forever. Thank you.
Good job. Well, I'm going to try to read to you because probably about 8 or 10 years ago, Beverly said to me, and Morris, you remember, I know, Carol, all of you were there, not enough spoons. And I thought, okay, well, I can have a fork. It would be okay. Until I understood what that meant, and that's what I want to tell you about. Spoon theory. Spoons are used as a metaphor and a visual representation for energy rationing. The spoon theory is a metaphor describing the amount of physical and or mental energy that a person has available for daily activities and tasks and how it can become limited. It was coined by writer and blogger, what a name, Christine Miserandino. Was she miseranding? In 2003, so a while back. It was a way to express how it felt to have lupus for her, using spoons at a restaurant to represent units of energy that a person might have to a friend. She reduced the spoons to represent how chronic illness forced her to plan out days and actions in advance so as to try to not run out of energy. It's since been used to describe a wide range of disabilities, mental health issues, forms of marginalization, and other factors that might place an extra and unseen burden on people living with them. While the origin was coined by Christine Miserandino in 2003, it was an essay called The Spoon Theory, and she was out at a restaurant with a friend. The friend was watching her as she stopped to take medication, and she asked her what it was like to have lupus. Miserandino grabbed the spoons from all around the diner where they sat and gave her friend a handful of spoons that she'd gathered. The spoons helped her show the way that people with chronic illness often start their days off numbering the spoons. And each spoon represented how much energy she had to spend that day. Different tasks require different spoons. So if you take away one of those spoons, like a big serving spoon or a little teaspoon, that activity has stopped. So if you were cooking, and we all know Beverly was cooking, a spoon would be needed. You have to select, which spoon can I use? And then you run out. So I'm not going to delay telling you that a fork won't do. You have to have spoons. May the spoons be everlasting.
Hello. Okay, we are here today to honor a very special person, my Aunt Beverly. She was the kindest, most positive person I've known. She was there to help.
Keep going.
Thank you, Uncle Morris. she was there to help, to make you feel comfortable and mothered in a way that made you feel special. Maya Angelou once wrote, "I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." Beverly made people feel seen and heard. She was beautiful, strong, and welcoming. She was unerring in her life, bent but never broken, always looking at the best in all people. She, along with my aunts and my father, had a most difficult childhood. It would have broken some people, but for Beverly, it made her stronger. And with that strength, she made others feel empowered to overcome any adversity. I found a poem that I thought described her perfectly, having to deal with that. It's called Invictus by William Ernest Henley. "Out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried out loud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody but unbowed. Beyond this place of wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. I am the captain of my soul. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged my with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate." Oh, it cut it off, sorry. Beverly's light will be missed now and forever.
Thank you. Hiya. Every time we heard hiya, we knew Aunt Beverly was here, along with that beautiful smile, zucchini bread, and so many other delicious treats that she made for us with such tender, loving care. But that was her general spirit. She gave to others with such a great deal of love and care. My Aunt Beverly exemplified a natural and fluid ability to stand as a pillar of strength and rise above adversity, trauma, and pain in her life. She had so many experiences that would have left most of us just broken, angry, and resentful. But she chose to elevate her heart above that. She chose to find joy and love and compassion for all others, everyone. Her ability to look beyond this has always resonated in my heart and has always influenced me, and she was my role model for that unconditional love and genuine kindness that she gave to others. And like her brother, my dad, Her love language was book sharing, and because of that, I've always held books sacred, especially those that are gifted to me by others, because they give them to you for a reason. They are telling you something. They are trying to teach you something. We still have a vintage Volkswagen book that she sent us because my husband restored Volkswagens, and we had several of them, so we have that there. But my favorite was for my high school graduation. She sent me several books with this note that I don't think she had any clue impacted me in my whole life. This note and every belief that she had in me helped me to strive to be better every day and treat others with kindness and love. And here's what her note said. It's very short, but it was so impactful for me, especially as a teen. Angela Abbott, I've given you my three favorite women authors. Margaret Atwood, especially, you should read more closely. I'm going to be passing around books written by you someday. My four favorite women authors. Love, Beverly. That's all she said. That belief in me, she knew I loved to write, and I've had a dream of doing that. And she instilled that belief in me. She probably didn't even realize it. But as I've aged, I now understand that her keen intuition that Margaret Atwood, the author of Handmaid's Tale, had so much to teach me as I grew into womanhood. And I look back, okay, I'm not gonna cry. I look back with that profound appreciation and her intention and desire to imprint her deep-rooted strength, thirst for knowledge, and wisdom in each of her nieces and her nephew. And for that, I will be always grateful, and she will always live in my heart and through my actions. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I do have a poem that really resonated with me. Got it. She took care of me. My sister's got my back. It's by Maya Angelou. Funny that we both chose Maya Angelou. When great trees fall, because she was our great tree. She was our great tree in this family. When great trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder, lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When great trees fall in forests, small things recoil into silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, and sterile. We breathe briefly, our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promised walks never taken. Great souls die and our reality bound to them takes leave of us. Our souls dependent upon their nurture now shrink, wizened. Our minds formed and informed by their radiance fall away. We are not so much maddened as reduced to the unutterable ignorance of dark, cold waves. And when great souls die after a period of peace blooms, slowly and always irregularly, space is filled with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses restored, and I feel that today with all of you. Never to be the same, whisper to us, they existed. They existed. We can be and be better, for they existed. Thank you.
I have a few more stories to share from friends. This one came from Denise White. She sent this. She said, Beverly to me is a saint. She gave unselfishly, wholly, and lovingly. She was a mother to me when my biological one could not be. She inspired me to carry on when all around me things seemed to fall apart. We attended some plays and poetry readings together and enjoyed listening to Moore's play on Campus Corner in Norman and at the beach that was at Lake Thunderbird. She directed me to not be afraid or cower down, but to stand tall and face the challenges on the mountain. Prior to working with her at IGA, I did not know anything about NPR or the Audubon Society or jazz. She was my mentor and will be greatly missed. This remembrance comes from Valerie Chandler. She said, last night, my dear friend Beverly went to her final home. COVID has taken another someone I know, and I want to tell you about how amazing and incredible she was. The following is my recollection, so if I get anything wrong, too bad. She never talked about it, but through little things that she said, I got the impression that her childhood was tough. Even in those circumstances, I know she found wonder and joy. When she was a young woman, she and a group of friends hitchhiked and traveled across the country. If they ran out of money, they'd work as waitresses. Then after they earned enough money, they'd travel to their next destination. What a wonderful adventure. She never attended college, but she was one of the most brilliant, well-read people I have ever known. She consumed books and knowledge like she breathed air, and she retained and understood the knowledge on a deep level. We had discussions, some over my head, about history and astronomy and religion and philosophy and everything. She was a huge fan of astronomy, astrophysics, Star Trek, also, all things Native American. She grew up in Oklahoma, so she knew many people who were Native Americans. She loved the Craig Johnson and Tony Hillerman books. She was also a professional baker and loved to bake and cook for people. That was her magic. She knew the food chemistry on an instinctive level that created works of art. Once during a book club meeting, her husband Morris said that after a full day of working at the bakery, standing all day, she'd come home exhausted and found joy in cooking. That was her thing. She loved it. And having been the recipient of such work, I can tell you that she knew her stuff. And having been, I can tell you that she knew that, and I will never forget the Mexican brownies that she made for book club. They were the best brownies I've ever tasted. I cut them in pieces, small pieces, to savor the flavor and make them last longer. They were amazing. But that was Beverly, a giver, always giving to others. She baked the bread for church communion. And once a year, a group of kids would travel through the area. She'd cook for them. Huge quantities of food. I think it was something like enough for three meals a day for 30 to 40 kids for a full week. It's a huge undertaking. Lots of casseroles and breads and desserts. And I haven't even gotten to the thing that impressed me the most. She had medical issues and was often in constant pain. And even during those times, her faith and goodwill never wavered. Her husband, Morris, is a piano player, and she loved to listen to him. She often said his music took the pain away when the meds could not. And even when they were flooded out of their home and moved in after the rebuild and were flooded again, her faith never wavered. She was like Job and the Dalai Lama, all rolled in together. She was a singer, philosopher, baking magician, devoted daughter, adoring wife, and dear friend. I'm sad that she never got to see the J. Webb telescope pictures, because I know she'd love them. But I think she's gone on to another realm, and what she sees is even better. Thank you, Beverly, for immensely enriching my life. We had 12 years of book club meetings, lunches, and lots of conversations, and I still hear her calming voice and laughter. She was an amazing and dear friend. You know, we have heard so many wonderful stories and memories about Beverly. What a beautiful tribute to her life this has been. How many lives she has touched. But in our earthly life, we have many titles, we have many things that we do, we have many identities. Beverly was many things to many people, but in all of our memories, there is a common thread that we've heard today, that she was a uniquely beautiful, gifted, intelligent, strong woman of faith who encouraged us, who made us better, stronger. She left a permanent mark on all of our lives, but our lives here are not permanent. We all prayed so hard that she would be healed. But this is the good news, is that she is healed. Sometimes healing only comes on the other side of this life, but healing always comes. The part of the celebration of Beverly's life is a witness to the word of God and to the power of resurrected life. I want you to hear these words from 2 Corinthians 5. It says, "So we are always confident because we know that while we are living in the body, we are away from our home with the Lord. We live by faith and not by sight. We are confident and we would prefer to leave the body and be at home with the Lord. So then from this point on, we won't recognize people by human standards. Even though we used to know Christ by human standards, that isn't how we know him now. So then if anyone is in Christ, that person is part of the new creation. The old things have gone away, and look, the new has arrived." The confidence that Paul speaks about from knowing who he really is. Beverly, I believe, knew who she really was in this life. Beverly knew and was confident that while we are living here, we are away from our home, our true home. But we can get so caught up in the here and now that sometimes that we forget what home truly is. The depth of Paul's message is that we see everyone from this vantage point, that maybe we need to remind each other who we are. That life, this life is not the pinnacle of our lives, ending with death. No, indeed, our physical lives are the temporary parts. Our spiritual lives are the permanent parts. Paul describes it also in this way in 2 Corinthians 5. Our bodies are like tents that we live in here on the earth. But when these tents are destroyed, we know that God will give each of us a place to live. These homes will not be buildings someone has made, but they are in heaven and will last forever. In fact, Morris, all of our lives are eternal. While we are here on earth, we sigh because we want to live in that heavenly home. We want to put it on like clothes and not be naked. These tents we now live in are like a heavy burden and we groan. But we don't do this just because we want to leave these bodies that will die. It's because we want to change them for bodies that will never die. God is the one who makes all this possible. He has given us the Spirit to make us certain he will do it. So always be cheerful. That scripture, I know it's difficult to be cheerful on this day, but this is our faith. This is who we truly are. It is a time to remember that Beverly has entered the great cloud of witnesses. All of us together in our souls, both here and now, and those who have passed beyond the veil, together in Christ. For as Paul reminds us, if anyone is in Christ, that person is part of a new creation. The old things have gone away, and look, the new has arrived. Beverly is new, more fully complete than she has ever been. And for that, today, we praise God. You can say amen to that. Amen. I'm sad for those of us who grieve in this place. This place in our hearts where she lives now feels empty and void, as if our love for her has no place to go and it just comes spilling out of our eyeballs. Beverly was my friend and the friend of my friends. And it's a deep loss. But she is part of us because we're never separated in this love that we share together. She was one of the most unique women I have ever met. She was so intelligent. You just wondered what was going on inside of that brain. She was a champion for injustices in our world, and she was not afraid to voice her opinion. She, of course, as we all heard, was an amazing baker. and was always ready to share her creations. Beyond all of this, she was an amazing woman of faith. As testimony shared today, that out of her own struggles and trials that she made us better. She was our encourager to stand up beyond these trials in life and make our lives better because of it. I so admired her faith because she had more than her portion of pain in this life. Her favorite scripture is Lamentations 3, verses 21 through 24. Would you hear this word? Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. Beverly Nelms, she was like a whirling dervish set loose upon our hearts. Thank you for getting that. She was timeless. She was a Renaissance woman, strong and steadfast, fierce, brave, a woman beyond our time, yet suffering because of our times. Broken, vulnerable, humbled, surrendered, her smile lit up a room and illumined our inner world with her presence. The curl of her lip with a witty grin, hands nimble, sewing, pondering, praying. Her laughter eliciting joy in the simplicity of life, a game with companions, a good and precious book, the stroke of a precious feline friend, water, flour, oil, the bread of life beneath her hands, the aroma of Christ in her kitchen. Such love and gratitude in Morris's hand and hers, companion, twin souls who found each other and held on for dear life. His hands on the keys, relieving her pain and taking her to an inner sanctuary of peace, overflowing joy. How blessed are we who have had the great privilege of having a moment of her life. And our time remains. Hers is now timeless. And until we all return as one, may we laugh a little louder in her honor. Listen more closely. Create and inspire in her honor. Stand up for the underdog in her name. Love and bless and heal with the one who now makes her complete. Those of us still here, we will miss her so much because we love her so much. We will always love her. That love within us never dies. We draw close to one another when we feel lost. We reach out to each other. We pray for each other. And that is my hope for all of you, that you would let that place in your heart for Beverly flow over to each other. Be close to Morris and to family and friends. Be Christ to them, because that's what she would have done. Share memories, laugh together, cry together, but knowing that we are never, ever separated from this great love. That love is holy, and it is present in this room right now. I would invite you to sing this hymn with us together. It is Holy, Holy, Holy. It is United Methodist Hymnal number 701. It'll be projected above.
On the bulletin, it says 700. It's actually number 64.
Wait, that's the last one.
Oh.
Correction to the correction.
64 is right.
Number 64.
I thought I said 64.
Thank you.
To say something here. Mark was doubling us on the bass over there. I don't know if you noticed it or not. William Billings, one of the first great writers of Sacred Harp music, had a concert of his music planned at a congregational church in New England, and they didn't allow musical instruments at all. William Billings wanted three bass singers for every single other singer. So if you had one tenor, and you had one treble, and you had one alto, he wanted three basses. That's the ratio he wanted. So when you see pump up to bass on the sticker, that's very American. It goes all the way back to the very beginning. William Billings didn't get enough bass singers to suit him for this singing. So he hired a cello player and brought the person in and stuck him in a closet so no one could see him, but so everyone could hear the bass parts.
Rock on. Absolutely. Would you stand as you are able? And would you pray with me? Gracious God, you have received Beverly into the arms of your mercy. You've raised Beverly up with all of your people. Receive us also and raise us into new life. Help us to love and to serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy. Father, we are grateful for Beverly's life, which has given us life, and our companion in this life. We thank you for all in her life that has made us better. We know that before she was ours, she is yours. Comfort us when the loss washes over us like a wave, and in the still waters, may we feel your peace. Amen. Would you join me in singing, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name?
This one's 154.
We do 1, 2, and 6.
Bring forth the Lord.
Indeed, as we go from this place, we invite you to go across the street over to the Fellowship Hall to have some refreshments and continue to share beautiful memories of Beverly. And as you go from this place, we do hail the name of Jesus Christ. Now may the Father, from whom every family in heaven on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being. So we go from this place. May you go in peace. Amen.
I am just a weary pilgrim wandering through this world of sin, and I'm looking for that city where the saints go marching in. Marching in,
marching in.
Oh, when the saints
come marching in, they go to be in that number. When the saints come marching in. Thank you all for coming. Very touched. I know she would be. And we're going to have some grub next door. So if you can stay in grease with us, as they say, please do.